May 17th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, Acts chapter 27 of the New Testament. When it was decided we would sail to Italy, they handed over Paul and some other prisoners to a centurion of the Augustan cohort named Julius. We went on board a ship from Adramyttium that was about to sail to various ports along the coast of the province of Asia and put out to sea. Accompanied by Aristarchus, a Macedonian from Thessalonica. The next day we put in at Sidon, and Julius, treating Paul kindly, allowed him to go to his friends so they could provide him with what he needed. From there we put out to sea and sailed under the lee of Cyprus because the winds were against us. After we had sailed across the open sea, off Cilicia and Pamphylia, we put in at Myra in Lycia. There, the centurion found a ship from Alexandria sailing for Italy, and he put us aboard it. We sailed slowly for many days and arrived with difficulty off Cnidus. Because the wind prevented us from going any farther, we sailed under the lee of Crete, off Salmone. With difficulty, we sailed along the coast of Crete and came to a place called Fair Havens that was near the town of Lycia. Since considerable time had passed and the voyage was now dangerous because the fast was already over, Paul advised them, "Men, I can see the voyage is going to end in disaster and great loss, not only of the cargo and the ship, but also of our lives." But the centurion was more convinced by the captain and the ship's owner than by what Paul said. Because the harbor was not suitable to spend the winter in, the majority decided to put out to sea from there. They hoped that somehow they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, facing southwest and northwest, and spend the winter there. When a gentle south wind sprang up, they thought they could carry out their purpose, so they weighed anchor and sailed close along the coast of Crete. Not long after this, a hurricane-force wind, called the Northeastern, blew down from the island. When the ship was caught in it and could not head into the wind, we gave way to it and were driven along. As we ran under the lee of a small island called Caudia, we were able with difficulty to get the ship's boat under control. After the crew had hoisted it aboard, they used supports to undergird the ship. Fearing they would run aground on the Cytis, they followed the sea anchor, thus letting themselves be driven along. The next day, because we were violently battered by the storm, they began throwing the cargo overboard. And on the third day, they threw the ship's gear overboard with their own hands. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and a violent storm continued to batter us, we finally abandoned all hope of being saved. Since many of them had no desire to eat, Paul stood up among them and said, "Men, you should have listened to me and not put out to sea from Crete, thus avoiding this damage and loss. And now, I advise you to keep up your courage, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only the ship will be lost. For last night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve came to me and said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar, and God has graciously granted you the safety of all who are sailing with you. Therefore, keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will be just as I have been told. But we must run aground on some island.' When the 14th night had come while we were being driven across the Adriatic Sea, about midnight the sailors suspected they were approaching some land. They took soundings and found the water was 20 fathoms deep. When they had sailed a little farther, they took soundings again and found it was almost 15 fathoms deep. Because they were afraid they would run aground on the rocky coast, they threw out 4 anchors from the stern and wished for day to appear. Then, when the sailors tried to escape from the ship and were lowering the ship's boat into the sea, pretending that they were going to put out anchors from the bow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, 'Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved.' Then the soldiers cut the ropes of the ship's boat and let it drift away. As day was about to dawn, Paul urged them all to take some food, saying, 'Today is the 14th day you have been in suspense and have gone without food. You have eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take some food, for this is important, for your survival, for not one of you will lose a hair from his head. After he said this, Paul took bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all, broke it, and began to eat. So all of them were encouraged and took food themselves. We were in all 276 persons on the ship. When they had eaten enough to be satisfied, they lightened the ship by throwing the wheat into the sea. When day came, they did not recognize the land, but they noticed a bay with a beach, where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. So they slipped the anchors and left them in the sea, at the same time loosening the linkage that bound the steering oars together. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and steered toward the beach. But they encountered a patch of cross currents and ran the ship aground. The bow stuck fast and could not be moved, but the stern was being broken up by the force of the waves. Now the soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners so that none of them would escape by swimming away. But the centurion, wanting to save Paul's life, prevented them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land, and the rest were to follow, some on planks and some on pieces of the ship, and in this way all were brought safely to land. God, I love watching, in this case, not just your relationship with Paul, but this triangulation between you and Paul, and how people are very closely watching that. And so we see in about verse 33 where he urges everybody to eat because he tells them they're going to be okay because of you. And he says, after he said this, Paul took bread and gave thanks to God in front of them all, broke it, and began to eat. And I think about that a lot. You know, there's so many people watching us. Fellow Christians are watching us. People who aren't Christians who are trying to figure out what that looks like. And then people who aren't Christians are trying to catch us doing something wrong. But no matter who they are, people are watching us. They're watching our actions. And so when you come into our life and just do amazing, crazy, awesome things, they're watching to see how we respond to that. Is it all about us? Do we take the credit for it? Or is it all about you, God? Do you come first and foremost in our mind, in our actions, that everything in this entire world that is good and honorable and fabulous is because of you? And not good in the way that we see good. I've got to be really clear about that, because we might think getting to go see a R-rated movie is good. Yeah, and I know that you don't so much. So whatever is good and honorable in your eyes, and all these amazing blessings you've given us, and all these people are watching how we react to that. They're also watching how we react to so-called bad situations. So almost drowning, kind of bad. But they're also watching as things of the world affect us. Let's say if we lose our job or a relationship breaks up, something happens with a child, maybe a fight with a child, and the world's watching how we react to that. And do we react as the world reacts, or do we react as one of God's children with a sense of peace in our heart, a decisiveness of forgiveness, as well as a reflection of who you are and being very clear about that? So God, today, I just love this reminder that people are constantly watching us, and we get to take intentional moments to show people who you are by our actions and by our words. And to me, that's probably one of the most amazing things that you've ever allowed us to do, is to be your disciples here on earth. I'm not so sure I would leave such an important job up to us, but apparently you believe in us way more than I would. I think that's just kind of crazy awesome. So thank you for that, God. And I just ask today that you give me strength to allow me to do everything I can in your name through my thoughts and actions and deeds. In your son's name I pray. Amen.